All right. Well, I'm going to welcome everybody from the States and around the world. I saw lots of different attendees in Ireland, England, Portugal, Vienna, and I'm sure I'm missing other people. And I'll just second what Catherine said. If you're having a problem with the audio being choppy, then just the best thing to do is dial in by the phone, and you'll get a perfect stream via our wonderful Bell networks. So today we're going to be talking about designing web interfaces, and this presentation doesn't cover, of course, everything in the book. The book's about three or four hundred pages, and the idea of the book came out of actually giving lots of talks and spending time at Yahoo as well as other places and also here at Netflix. My background, going back to 1985, was writing a game for the Macintosh called Gato, a submarine simulation. That's where I got my real interest in interaction design and user interface design and user interface engineering. Later, I did a library called Rico, which is an AJAX framework, and then at Yahoo, I did the Yahoo Design Pattern Library, some of the work that's in the book is based on the pattern library research I did there. And now I'm at Netflix, where I direct the user interface engineering, and obviously just released the book. What we're going to be talking about today is really about interaction and interaction design, and specifically kind of a narrow slot of how to do those microstate, those really detailed interactions, give lots of examples and various patterns to illustrate the nuances of good interaction design. So the talk's not really about visual design. It's not really about information architecture. It's not about writing HTML code or CSS, those sort of things. The focus is about interaction design for rich web experiences. Newton's third law of motion, we'll just abuse it and apply it here. For every action, there's an equal and opposite reaction. A bird flies because the pressure of the air pressure as it flaps its wings. In the same way, a user interacts with an interface and gets feedback. And if you don't get feedback in a timely, a correct manner that leads you forward into the interaction, then your feeling is that the interface is not intelligent, it's stupid, and you, of course, personalize the interface and start, if we don't curse at it, we get pretty angry at it. And so it's about the nuance, and it's about making things interactive just at the right moment of time. We're going to talk about six principles today. And that's what makes up the book itself, too. And these principles listed on the screen: make it direct, keep it lightweight, stay on the page, provide imitations, use transitions, and react immediately. And this will form the foundation for patterns and put them in context. So in the book and in my pattern research, I've been collecting design patterns for a while. And these design patterns I have listed here. This is a number of those that are in the book. There's actually some more that are in the book that aren't listed here. We won't talk about all these patterns today, but we'll touch on a number of these as we go through. Patterns are just a good way to codify different user interface idioms and give a pithy name to it so that you remember it and you can communicate between design and engineering and product management and those sort of things. So, I'm having, Catherine, just let you know, I'm having a pop-up that keeps coming up. I'm going to try to deal with that real quick here. I apologize to everybody, and then I can get back to my concentration, but it's pretty annoying.
We're not seeing it, Bill.
I'll also say to everybody that the WebEx interface is not something that I built. All right, we'll move on. The first principle is make it direct. And this is really about trying to make interaction as direct to the user as possible. Alan Cooper said this in a great way. He said, allow input wherever you have output. And so along in the web, it was really a read-only web. For the longest time, you get a page, it was static. You could have a form, you could do some input and fields, and you'd post it and get a page coming back. But to have something that's really interactive as you work with it and you get that feedback right away and that directness, that just didn't really exist on the web. And so allowing input wherever there's output is a great technique. And you can look at an example of just inline editing, for example. Flickr, The old way of doing it was you display a photo, you click an edit link, you go to another page, and then you do the editing there, and then you come back and see the results. And so shortening the length of interactions is one of those techniques you can do with something called inline editing. It makes objects directly actionable. For example here, if you look to the right on the Flickr example, which says front grounds, as soon as I hover over the word front grounds, the title, I get a light yellow background, I get a click to edit. These are invitations, a hover invitation, a tooltip invitation, that you know cues you that you need to do some other interaction. So that when, as soon as I click, I get the actual edit affordance so I can start editing, and there's also a save and cancel button that comes into play. And then once I hit save, it says saving, gives me feedback, and it gets saved. And those are all the interesting moments that kind of pass through an interaction. Here in an older example of Yahoo bookmarks, I've got a list of my bookmarks from around the web. And if you notice, the mouse is right over the edit link. And so the edit link kind of serves as an invitation to inline editing. As soon as I click it, it expands open, and what I can see is an edit panel that shows up, and I can change the title, I can change the tags. Here I'm adding a tag called cool, and then I can save it, although they have the word edit for the button, which is a little odd. But imagine that being the word save, which would have been a better choice, and it saves it, and now it's part of my read-only aspect of the page. So I didn't have to leave the page. I could do this directly. This is definitely an example of make it direct and inline editing. Considerations you need to think about with inline editing and making things direct is discoverability. Now, I'm going to table the discoverability discussion for a little bit later in the talk when we talk in detail about invitations. Complex editing, though, is one of those things that you get into. It's not just a single field you want to edit. So here in 37 Signals Back Packet, when I hover over a title from my list, I get the edit link in a trash can. I also get a drag icon. I'm going to click on the edit link, and it starts transitioning. There's a crossfading happening between the read-only mode and the edit mode, where it brings in more complex editing. And now I have the title, I have the body, I have the form, and all that was brought into place, so I really didn't have to go to another page to do this. Just a nice way to blend those together. And then when I get done, there's a spotlighting effect that highlights it yellow and that fades out to let me know that got changed. Also, another approach is to blend the modes really well together. Here in Yahoo 360, we had a bubble, and when I was working with the design team on this, one of the goals we had was to try to make it seamless between the actual display of the status in the bubble, the blast, and when you actually edit it. So if you click on the edit blast, it's in the right-hand corner of that bubble, the bottom corner, what happens is, in just about the same space, there's just a tiny bit of difference in space, you get an edit field, you can also set a URL, a link that you want to share, and you can also change it from a quote to some other style of bubble. In this case, I do it to a thought bubble. And it immediately changes. So you're getting the feedback just in place. It's really just a what you see is what you get, a WYSIWYG. Another concern around inline editing is accessibility. Because you've collapsed the space, sometimes the events are AJAX-based or other kinds of micro-events, and some of the screen reader technology, for example, may not always pick up on that. They're getting better with that, but there's times they don't. So one approach is like Flickr does. The same thing we saw just a minute ago, I did the inline editing in place. Here, in the same page where the photo was that I could do the inline editing, there's a little panel for additional information. Now, it's not that obvious, and this could be improved, but just showing me the point that there's an edit link. And if I say edit the title, it then takes me to a second page and allows me to do the title, description, and tags. Definitely the old school variety, but it works with JavaScript, say, and disabled. And it also works really well with screen readers and any accessibility assistive technologies. Another thing to consider in inline editing is group editing. You've got a bunch of things at once on the screen that are in read-only mode, but you want to edit them kind of in bulk. iPhone gives a kind of an example of this where you have the ability to rearrange icons on the iPhone screen. So what happens is, and this is not very discoverable, this is a good example of that, but if you actually hold down on one of the icons, they get jiggly and they start wiggling, right? You've probably seen this. And then once they're in the wiggly mode, you can move them around. And then once you get done, the way you turn it off, which is really odd, you don't just hold back down on the icon and make it turn off. You actually go and hit the home button, and that takes you back to the non-jiggly mode, the static mode of the icons on the screen. And that's the problem with that is that it's not symmetrical. And one of the things you want to do when you're dealing with inline editing is you want to have a symmetry of interactions, what I call it, so that the activation and deactivation modes are as alike as possible, so that once you learn the technique to turn something on, you turn it off the same way. A light switch on the wall, thank God it just toggles. You know, there's usually a sensible way to do the opposite action. In this case, I think they could have done a better job, but again, I wasn't privy to all their decision making. In Basecamp, which is another 37 Signals product, I have a list of all my files that I'm sharing. And each one of those is listed here. You see there's like five of them listed. And what I'd like to do is be able to edit those. Well, I see an edit link in the top right corner. So when I click that, each one of those gets some in-context tools, some contextual tools that show up, rename, you know, the trash can for the drafts, add another category. And there's an obvious toggle to turn it back off, the done editing. So the done editing is the switch from the editing. That's very symmetrical. It's in the same place, and it also changed wording, so I know exactly what to do. It's, you know, pretty very intuitive. It leads you through the process once you just click the edit link. So kind of a principle, if readability is more important than editing, then you want to keep the editing action hidden until the user interacts with the content. You know, one of the things you struggle with, like we could have, if you look at that 37 Signals Basecamp example on the right-hand side, you'll see that it's pretty busy when you're in the edit mode. If you didn't have this toggle, then you'd have to put all these edit controls everywhere in the interface. And instead, you can hide those because that's not the primary mode. The primary mode is to be able to scan and know which files you have and click the link and go to a file. So it's a nice way to kind of tuck away hidden behavior. Drag and drop. One of the challenges with directness, especially in drag and drop, is, you know, people immediately think first that drag and drop will make something intuitive. But sometimes drag and drop is not the right choice, as we'll see in a few minutes. But one of the real things that happens when you try to design drag and drop is there's a lot of really micro states or interesting moments. When I was at Yahoo, and we were first building the Yahoo User Interface Library, the YUI library, I was fortunate to be able to work with the team closely in that beginning phase. And one of the things we did was try to understand what were all the little micro states when you're building a toolkit like that for drag and drop that you want to have available for the design team and the engineers to take advantage of to create the best experience. So, you know, for a while what I did was we went to meetings and we would discuss all the nuances, and I had a 20 or 25 page document that talked about pretty much everything you might possibly conceive of ever doing in every possible state in drag and drop. Well, you know, obviously that's a very bulky way to do it. So what I ended up doing was just creating an interesting moments grid. And so what happens is it's just a simple grid you can create. Along the top, you'll see the events running from left to right along that axis. And you'll see mouse over, mouse down, drag initiated. It goes on. There's about 12 or 13, maybe 14 different states that can be interesting in a drag and drop. You know, when I first hover, when I click down, when I initiate the drag, all those sort of things are interesting moments within the drag and drop interaction that you might want to do something with the user to cue them and let them know that things are still going well and what's going to happen next. So along the left-hand side, going from the top to the bottom, is the various actors or objects that get involved in the interesting moments, the cursor, the module that's being dragged, even the idea of the drag module's original location, you know, where you pulled it from, or the drop target. And there can be more of these. In this example here, I'm just showing a technique with the My Yahoo and how it was done when this was implemented. So that's a technique you can use. It's pretty lightweight. And what you can do is you can just kind of create a grid like that, sketch it out by pencil, don't get too fancy with it, jot notes in it, and it kind of becomes a really great document to share between design and engineering. I know that our engineering team on My Yahoo, when I was there, and appreciated that as well as other teams when we shared it around. So with drag and drop, discoverability is going to be one of those issues that you run into. And the hover invitation and interesting moments are all things you need to think about. Activation of mouse down, you know, tips during the time when you're dragging it or alternate paths you could take, providing additional visual affordances. So here is an example. When I was at Yahoo, I was working on a product called Yahoo for Teachers, and we had a tool that I built and designed called the Gobbler, funny name, I know. But the idea was it could gobble content from around the web, and this was a few years ago, early on in the kind of clipping services concept. What you do is for a teacher, they could go and find images, text quotations, links, and they could harvest those into the Gobbler into projects, and those projects can be shared with other teachers around the world and then put into lesson plans. So the idea was you'd be on any web page. It could be, now it wasn't a Yahoo page necessarily, it could be any web page. You pop up the Gobbler, and that's the thing that's hanging there to the right that's green and kind of tan. And as soon as you hover over an image in the page, for example, you get that slight orange highlighting and a blue kind of selection overlay. So what that's doing without even clicking anything, you know, oh, it gives us something that I can interact with. So we're taking advantage of the interesting moment of just kind of inviting the user to do something. You see a hand, the cursor changes to a hand to, you know, to give an indication that you could drag this thing. And then as soon as you start to pull, you get this kind of ripped effect where the original location has a dashed line around it. And the dashed line kind of gives the feeling it's been ripped out, and then you've got a thumbnail version of what you're dragging that exactly fits the target in one of the Gobbler panels. So then as I drag over that and I get close to it, the target lights up to say, yeah, I'm here, and you can drop me here. And then when you drop it, you know, things return to normal. So there was one other state in there you might notice that I could have done something. As soon as you start to drag it, all the drop targets could have lit up slightly to let you know that they were all targets, and that was one thing I intended to do but never got around the time to implement that. In Netflix, we have drag and drop, and some of you may be surprised. I know that after I got at Netflix, I had some friends ping me and say, hey, thanks for adding drag and drop to the queue. And I said, well, actually, I didn't. It was already in there for a year prior to me getting here. It's just that it's not discoverable. And we actually have a large project we're working on right now to make Netflix drag and drop in the queue discoverable. We know it's not, and we have a lot of ideas, and we're filling them and trying them. For example, when I hover, this is a real light effect, you know, on the row. It does turn into a hand. If I start dragging, I do get the feedback. I know where I'm ripping from, and then I drop it. And we've done some things since this this little animation I showed you. One is a while back last year when we were just cleaning up the queue and rewriting it from a coding perspective, I had Darren, one of the engineers, put in a little hook so that when you do the move to top, it does a little jig down and then flies up. So it animates the move, it does the little bump down and up to make you feel like you can tear it and rip it. And that's just kind of hinting at the fact that this thing can be moved. We have a number of ideas. You know, some of them are, most of them are based around the concept of giving the user some kind of clue at the moment of an alternate interaction. For example, if you do a move to top, well, another way to do the move to top is to do drag and drop, right? The move to top is pretty efficient if you know about it. Again, the move to top icon here is not very good. We've improved that on our current website, although I think it still needs some more improvement. So if you do the move to top, you can imagine at that point in time leaving the hole where the thing moved from, the movie moved from to go to the top of the queue, and having a message there for the first time it ever happens and saying, did you know you can also drag and drop and learn more and even show it in an animation, you know, in the live interface. So those are just some things we're exploring, and stay tuned, and hopefully you'll have some better ideas on that and be blocking that in the future. So one thing to consider with drag and drop is, you know, it's not just for simple things like setting an attribute. Here's an example from a Flex demo where they were setting, they were wanting to pick real estate properties and add them as a favorite. And the way they do it, you'll see there's a row highlighted, and I actually begin to drag that. If you look at the blue area that's got the heart, right above it, you'll see a row that's being dragged. It's hard to see because it's small. Most of these I actually have on the companion Flickr site, by the way. You can find on designingwebinterfaces.com the full-size images of all these screenshots. But anyway, as you drag this down, that area says, you know, make this a favorite. So you have to drag the real estate item into the blue area to make it a favorite. You can't just click on it. And once you do, it becomes a favorite. And for some odd reason, it actually moved to the bottom. So that really makes it confusing in the interface. But to get rid of the favorite, you have to go look at the favorites and then drag them down into that blue area with the yellow trash can to get rid of them. Another example of an artificial visual construct created just to support drag and drop is this simple little DVD example, rating example of movies. And you can see what's happening is I'm dragging a movie down into the loved it, and there's also the haven't seen it and loathed it categories. So to actually rate a movie, what I end up having to do is drag it into one of the slots. So, you know, don't create an artificial visual construct just to support drag and drop. I mean, Netflix did this in 2000, I think, was when it first came out, had the ratings. And you just click a star and you rate something. And you think, okay, well, that's pretty obvious. But, you know, when I was at Yahoo, we were looking at redesigning the Yahoo finances for the new finance chart and all the other stuff they have in there now. The team was pretty excited about using all this H-axis stuff, and they were like, let's do drag and drop. You know, you can drag and drop a list of your stocks that are your common stocks you've been looking at and drag them into the chart. I said, well, they're already listed. Why not just have a checkbox beside them? If you check them, they show up in the chart. You don't need to go all the extra problem of dragging and dropping it. We can just click, you know, to add something. So it does creep in even with the best designers. So the next principle goes with this first one, making it direct. It's about keeping it lightweight. And this is really about shortening, you know, keeping a light footprint throughout the site so that when users interact, they can interact as lightly as possible. A lot of this is about even the concept of click weights and thinking about how heavy the interaction is. Contextual tools are a great way to do this. What are contextual tools? Well, in this example with Dig, which was very important for Dig's success early on, this is a Dig It button right beside the news article. So you put a tool right in context with the content to be able to interact with it. So you don't have to guess and go to a menu system or a toolbar elsewhere. It's brought into context with it. And when you hit the dig button, it says it's been dug. And Kevin said at a BayCon a couple of years ago, been here in the Bay Area of California, he said that this adding this little simple micro interaction drastically changed the participation level and the success of the site, which is a pretty incredible statement. So Gap has a concept of remembered collections, which is really a shopping cart in context, if you will. So I'm looking at an item. In the top right corner, there's a little yellow button called checkout. It might be a little hard to see. But as soon as I click that, you see the thing that slid out is the shopping cart. So you're putting the shopping right there in context, which is sort of similar to, you know, you're going down the final aisle to check out at the grocery store, and there's all the impulse items. It makes the shopping experience much more impulsive. You can just, without having to leave the page and go somewhere else, you can do it. Very light footprint. Flickr, I've got a friend, Lancella, Lance, and I'm going to hover over his icon, face, and then what I get is I get a drop-down affordance. And that drop-down affordance is in yellow. It's got a little blue arrow pointing down. And when I hover over it, it turns dark blue, inviting me to do the next thing. I click on it, and then I get the list of things I can do with the actual contact or person. So that's an in-context tool. The drop-down tool, it's like a right-click menu in essence, but it's actually in context with the item itself. and kind of neatly tucked away. Same thing with 37 Signals back packet. Here's a to-do list. I hover over of milk. I get the edit link and I get the trash can. I can click to edit and start editing. Now, the same thing with stars as we saw earlier. You know, I hover. This is Yahoo News. Same thing with Netflix, Yahoo Movies. If I hover over one of the ratings for the movie, it says what it is, be good, etc. Interesting note on this one, though, even though it's a lightweight thing to go click one of the ratings, at Yahoo, we knew that a good number of users actually didn't like this interface for rating movies, and the self-reported reason through our surveys was that there were too many choices, and this probably gets back to the concept of the paradox of choice. If you not read that book, it's an interesting read about the more choices you have, the less satisfied you are with your choice. It's possibly simpler just to have a star rating or to have something even simpler like just a thumbs up, thumbs down, you know, like the TiVo sort of interface. Contextual tools really are the same as the old context menus, like the ribbon bar, you know, in Vista, or the right-click menu. However, unlike them, where you could select multiple objects and then right-click and get a menu that operates on the selection of items, each tool is in context with the object that it interacts with, so it's really only good for single objects. For example, I'm just dealing with that single list item there. I can't deal with the whole list at once. And the same thing with the Flickr one. You know, I'm just dealing with the one contact, which in this case is okay. It can actually slow you down, though. This last example that pops in with the back packet, you can see that I've clicked lettuce and tomatoes at the same time, and I'm actually waiting on both of them to finish making their server call to update the actual to-do item. Now, the latest versions of Backpacket, this is a lot faster, and you don't really ever see this happen. But it does raise the issue that, you know, every action doesn't have to happen instantly. It can be recorded on the client side and then, you know, batched up and sent later. There's ways to make the interface feel like it's immediately responsive and that you're not doing a bunch of little micro-interactions. You're just interacting with the item, the object itself, and you're not having to pay attention to that. In this case, what would happen sometimes during the update, one would not get checked because when it returned the result, only one was checked instead of two. But that's been long fixed, fortunately. Removing the pain points is another big point about this whole contextual tools. Somebody just had said the TiVo interface, elaborate on that. That's basically the thumbs up, thumbs down is what I was talking about, not the whole TiVo interface, the menu system, but the idea of thumbs up and thumbs down. So removing the pain points is really about knowing, you know, the user's flow. You can't get away from that. You have to understand how the users interact, what their primary actions are in an interface, and then start identifying all the hurdles and all the speed bumps and all the things that you've erected in their way to just accomplish the simplest things. And you need to shorten that path as much as possible. For example, you know, instead of dragging something to rate it, you just click a star. You keep the actions immediate and lightweight, like in Dig, and you use hover, blur, focus, and the lightweight events are good ways to make something lightweight instead of having to do a triple click or a shift control triple click, which obviously would be ridiculous, although, as you know, in Microsoft Word, there are triple clicks. Fortunately, I haven't seen those on the web. I did see one time where there was a dictionary site that every word that was listed, although there's no cue to this, if you double-clicked it, thinking you were selecting the text, it would actually go and take you to the definition of that word, which was kind of disturbing. So click weight is this concept of, you know, how heavy is the interaction. It could be the amount of time it takes the user to find something on the page. It could be the amount of time it takes the user to make a decision once they've seen the things they can do. It can be involved a second guessing of whether something's actually the correct thing to do. It could be the wait time that you're having to wait for something to finish. And it could be the number of interaction steps. A very simple thing is to count, is to assign a wait to everything the user has to do. For example, you could say a single click is 1 point, a double click, 2 points, or maybe it's a 1.5, you know, points. You can make that a little more lightweight. Triple click, you might weigh 3, you know. And then having to navigate a cascade menu might be a 3, you know. So this whole concept of that kind of gives you an idea of what's heavier and what's more lightweight. A lightweight event would just be hovering over something. A heavy kind of event would be something that requires, you know, some dexterity, or especially like, you know, double click. Although sometimes users just double click everything, and there's no difference between single click and double click with them. Shift clicks, those sort of things, they're all heavier sort of clicks. But sometimes it's like the silly flyout menus that it takes a mouse gymnast to actually navigate to keep the silly thing from collapsing on you. And some of that can be fixed by time delays and other things. But there are so many of those on the web, it's ridiculous, and it really makes it difficult. So you can count those interaction steps for anything, and then you can shorten those paths. It's not just about removing those number of steps. Sometimes, as Jared Spool talked about, he had this study he did called the Confidence Game. And what they did was they gave users directed tasks, and as long as the users felt like they were narrowing in on what they were going to, what you know, the accomplishment, the goal, the success, they reported a very happy user experience even with lots of steps. Now, that would not apply to repetitive types of items, but for a first-time experience, it's okay to take somebody through a number of steps as long as they really feel like they're getting somewhere and they're, you know, narrowing down on their goal. You know, we're very goal-oriented. You know, humans are very goal-oriented, and you know, game theory and theory of fun and all that stuff. There's a great book called Theory of Fun, by the way, that goes into some of this. And also Kathy Sierra's blogs talk a lot about this whole thing of leading you to the next level. So don't just think that, you know, it has several steps, it's bad. But if it's something that's very you know, common to do and repetitive, you want to shorten those steps. It's really about a cost-benefit trade-off. So some anti-patterns, and when I talk about anti-patterns, what I mean that these are things that, these are patterns you should avoid. These are patterns of bad idioms. Here's an example from Yahoo Teachers, which is no longer a product, but when I was at Yahoo, we were working, and this is a Skuntworks project, and it had a number of images showing, and what would happen is when I came in and took the product over, this was the state of the interface. You would hover, and this is a flyout. This flyout doesn't actually show on the interface. I'm zooming in now to show you what the interaction was like. So imagine now I'm looking at two images in that whole array of images, and as soon as my mouse hovers over this leftmost image that's in that callout, you see that it has a contextual tools that fly out. Now the problem is I got the copy, delete, and preview, and I can link over to the actual you know, item that I've got saved here, but it covered the next image. And so what happens is if I'm going to actually navigate from one to the other and say do deletes, I've got to do this zigzag sort of thing with my mouse. You know, it comes up, it does a hover, and it covers any other places to navigate. And so I have to go outside of it to make it collapse and come back to the other one to get the tools. So it gets to be really problematic. So a simple solution to fix that is you see the pane that just came up, when you hover, we gave the images a little more breathing room, white space, and when you hover over, we changed the way we laid out the preview and the copy and delete, so they actually show up in context without having to do an overlay, just made visible, so it's faster. We got rid of the rounded corners, by the way, to make it a little quicker at the time, and there's also a muscle memory involved, because as I move from item to item, that delete's going to show up in the same place, and it's going to be there for me even though it doesn't show up. So you can kind of play off the you know, a person's ability to have muscle memory in this situation. Another anti-pattern is mystery meat in this area. You know, you want to keep it lightweight, so what you do is when you hover, this is a very early zoomer, it's better now. You got these icons, and for the life of me, I don't know that I understand a single one of these icons. I think the bubble one's probably information. I don't know. But you have to actually hover over them to get a tooltip, hope for a tooltip to be able to see it. And the right-hand side, another anti-pattern from the teacher product that I took over, it had a little baseball card concept where here's Derek, and he's a teacher, and I want to find out about him. How do I find out about him? Well, I'd probably click on the picture. But actually, if you hover, excuse me, if you hover, you'll see a little, an arrow that shows up, this little divot. And this little arrow divot now is something you can click, and when you click it, it opens up to show you the baseball card. Now, the problem, though, is that little divot doesn't show up here, so I have no idea it's there. Okay, that's great. Hover invitation. Maybe it's good enough. But the thing is so small. You know, it's this tiny target. And Fitts' law basically says that, you know, if the time it takes to acquire the target is directly in relation to the size and the distance the target is from you. So if something's really small, it's going to be harder to click on. That's just kind of obvious, isn't it? If something is large, you know, it's going to be easier. Of course, there's a balance between what you can do. You can't just have everything huge. But an 8x8 is really a tiny target. And then knowing to click it and those sort of things. So most teachers didn't discover that. So the next principle, I'll move to the third one. And okay, somebody was, it's Fitts Law, F-I-T-T-S, Law. You can look it up. Wikipedia has a great article on it. Fitts Law, F-I-T-T-S. Stay on the page is another principle that's that it's very, very important for making rich interactions. And the way you can do that is one approach is overlays. Now, I don't mean dialog pop-ups. I don't mean other browser. I don't mean browser window pop-ups. I mean the more lightweight, in the world of DHTML, we would use a div or an overlay. It's something right there in the page that's very quick to pick up, to pop up. Doesn't require the operating system to create a window, so it's not slow. It can be positioned or repositioned, those sort of things. In the case of Netflix here at the top, what's going on there is this is actually an overlay after I've added a movie to my queue to ship to me. I get this overlay, and the overlay shows me confirmation as well as some other recommended movies that are similar or that I might like that are related to the movie I just added. And this actually is a very, very important thing for Netflix. We get a lot of our ads to queue from this recommendation layer, and it actually turns out to be very successful. I think I have a little more discussion about that later to talk about the nuances of that. But that overlay comes up. Here's a lightweight kind of detail overlay. Instead of a dialogue overlay, when you put your mouse over the box shot of the movie, say for this example, 30 Rock, the TV show series, what I get after about a quarter to half a second delay, a back of the box kind of view of the movie comes up. It shows the details, the predictive ratings for me and those sort of things, who's in it, etc. It's nice because as I'm moving around, it's not popping up all the time. It only pops up when I pause long enough, and this is just the basic concept of the way tooltips were always done. But you'd be surprised how many times you see this implemented on the web and people provide no delay, or the delay is way too long. You have to get the timing right so that you can kind of discern the user's intent as they're trying to find out about this movie. And it's one of those things that once you've kind of moved around and had this pop up, you know that it's going to be there for you, and it's very intuitive once you've stumbled upon it. So discoverability is not too, you know, too bad. Actually, it's not bad at all. American Express has this interesting interface that as you move from field to field, they have an overlay kind of wrap around it. And it's actually not disturbing, surprisingly. It's actually a pretty nice way they've done it. They give you all the information, so when you're filling out, you know, your application or whatever, there's just really no question of what you need to do. The nice thing is, you know, as you move from field to field, it changes, and then if you click somewhere else, it goes away, so it's, you know, collapses real well, and it's a nice way to lead somebody through a form that might be a little more complex, although I don't know how complex a credit card application is, but you can imagine a real estate form or a loan form using this kind of a pattern. Overlays, as we talked about. Now, here's an anti-pattern and called idiot boxes. And this was the old Yahoo Photos. And what I've got is I've got some photos, and what I want to do is drag them to an album on the left-hand side. So I select them. It's got a nice drag, and you've got the three items that are selected at the top. I start dragging it. I've got a thumbnail of it. So far, so good. And then it continues to zoom it down, you know, so it's easy to, you know, carry around. It feels good. I hover over the album, but notice there's no feedback in the album telling me that it's, hey, this is an interesting moment. You can drop me here. And so what happens is the designers, knowing that this was problematic, instead of fixing the invitational point, the interesting moment point, they added inserted a dialogue that says, a confirmation dialogue says, add three photos to Paris, you know, the Paris 06 album. And so now I've got to say, okay, I mean, obviously I dragged the thing there and I dropped it. You know, I don't need a confirmation box. I don't need to, like Alan Cooper calls it, interrupting the proceedings with idiocy. And so that's where I got the term idiot box from, that, inspired by that statement by Alan. And then we get dancing hamsters. Yes, they actually dance back and forth and back and forth. And that can be really annoying if you see that a lot, because now it's kind of emphasizing the slowness of the interface. And then I get a third box, which says, hey, we did what you said you wanted to do. Aren't you proud of us? Three photos added to Paris 06, and you have to say, okay. So there's a lot of clicks in there when basically all I'm doing is just dragging the photos there. Somebody had mentioned how to do undo, or asked the question, you could have an undo link beside there. That would be one way to do it. But it's also one of those things where it's not that hard, because you're dragging these things and just organize them, and you can re-drag them elsewhere in the sense of organization. Undos sometimes, you know, can be in the way. So here's another anti-pattern. Again, this is Hover and Cover. And this is on Barnes & Noble's, and it was still there the last time I saw it, and they may have changed it. But what happens is they got the idea to show more details. When I hover over the dictionary, what do I get? I get exactly the same thing that was shown on the screen, just formatted differently. Well, what's the point of that? Now it covers the next item, and so when I hover over it and I can't get to the next item, I have to go way outside of it and come back. Case where you don't need the pop-up, you don't need the details at all, and you're falling into the trap of Hover and Cover to boot. Amazon, good for merchandising, but this is an idea of the mouse trap. So basically you move your mouse around and it's like, you know, the trap is springing on you all the time. I just hover over Ray, the original motion picture soundtrack link, and boom, this thing flies out at me. And to get rid of it, I can't just move outside of it. It's not like, you know, I hover and I, you know, de-hover or mouse out. I have to go click that little close box in the right-hand corner of the Amazon bar. Now, this probably works well from a merchandising perspective because, you know, look, pop-unders work and dancing cowboys, you know, work for selling mortgage ads. But from a user interface perspective, this is a good example of a mousetrap, and also earlier we talked about the symmetry of interaction, or it's not symmetrical. Hover to activate and have to find the close box to get rid of it. Inlays are like overlays, except they're brought into the page itself. So in this example here, I'm on Google, or actually, I'm sorry, this is my Yahoo, and I'm going to click the little gear icon to edit the configuration of this top stories from the AP, and it begins to slide out a panel, and you see my article slid down, and there's a panel now there that I can set display up to four items or five. I'll change it to five, and now it starts to slide down, and now I have five items. So it's a way to slide an inlay. It's an in-context configuration. With the accordion, the same kind of concept, although accordions sometimes are way overused and are really a pain because you only see one item at a time. Here I'm doing a refining on Yahoo Autos for finding a car, but I can only see one thing at a time, so I don't really know what all my configurations are without having to look at each one individually. That could be fixed, you know, by having a summary panel or by putting some kind of summary in the same line with the header of the panel, or allowing multiple ones to be open at a time. BBC has the same kind of inlay concept on configuration. I want to be able to change the content on the page, and so right under the words, the logo BBC, there's a little link there to customize your page. And I click that, and it starts to slide down and expose a panel that allows me to configure the content on the page. And I can do it in context with the rest of the page. And that's really the difference between the overlay and the inlay, is that with inlays, I can keep the context of the page around me as I work on whatever it is. It's kind of the same. It's just a very contextual way to do things. Here's Roost, and they have this. Roost is a real estate site, and they have Insight, being able to look into the real estate property without leaving the page, which is really nice. As soon as I hover, I get a set of contextual tools that show. I click on the view the photos. It kind of opens up, expands the inlay panel there, and shows me all the various images. And when I hover over one of them, I actually get a overlay of the house itself. So it uses the inlay and the overlay to give a lot of contextual information right there without having to go page to page to page. It's a very enjoyable site. The Roost team has done a good job on that. So, you know, when we're talking about staying on the page, it's a lot about rethinking the old concept of chunking and paging. With a real estate site, you know, I'd scroll back and forth, you know, by paging. But like with Microsoft Live, with their image search, I can continue to hit the scroll bar and it just automatically, dynamically loads more content in as I go. Carousels are another way to do that. You can bring in content side of them. They're really good for, you know, something that from a search that's high relevancy to begin with, because people don't want to go real far down a carousel, it's too tedious. Or, you know, it's chronological kind of information. It's really good for that. And then Yahoo Mail had introduced, you know, when it came out a few years back, the new version, on-demand scrolling. So instead of a page model, like for example in Gmail, I can drag the scroll bar, and even though the content's not really on the client side, it starts loading it in and brings it in. It would be nice if there was a tooltip with a scroll bar that told you where you were at in your sorted, you know, view, so you could obviously know where you're going as you scroll, or some other kind of indication. But unfortunately, that product does not have that. Zoomable interfaces and in-place paging or other ways. Inlist.com, I think it's owned by Amazon now, if I'm not mistaken. I can page through, as you would normally think. There's a little overlay panel that comes up for paging. When I do that, I don't actually go to another page. Just the content area pages in. And so the rest of the page stays stable, and it gives me a real lightweight feel, and I get this concept of feeling like I'm staying on the page, even though I'm really bringing in more pages. Zoomable user interfaces, which you're seeing now more with Silverlight and Flash. Here's the Hard Rock Cafe down with Silverlight. Zoomable user interface. This is all their memorabilia, and I can start zooming in on a particular item and go all the way down to the button, which is kind of a cool interface. Cool Iris, which is a plugin for Firefox and other browsers, that allows you to Google images or Flickr images, be able to look at them in a scrollable 3D kind of sliding wall of images. These are all examples of being on the same page, but making the page feel a lot larger, extending the real estate through making it virtual. Rethinking the process flows. You know, you don't have to make everything page to page to page. Gap has an inline assistant, so as I check on various colors and things, it gives me instant feedback whether something's available or not. The same thing here with the checkout we looked at earlier. There are all ways to cut down all the steps. And, you know, Broadmoor Hotels, probably 4 years ago now, maybe five, when they converted their reservation system over to a single page interaction, their conversion rates, this is it here, their conversion rates went up by 40%. And so this interface is a little bit busy, a little bit clunky, it's a little dated after a few years, but what happens is I'm setting the calendar and I'm seeing everything in real time change on the same page. A much better, pleasant experience and a lot fewer bailouts. So, you know, step by step, those does work, like this discover.com, you know, stepping me setting my profile up, it kind of interrupts the process, but it's pretty lightweight, just a few steps to do something. Our help center on Netflix, report a problem. You want the confirmation staff to know that they've reported it, and so those step-by-steps are good in that case. So not everything has to be, you know, a single interactive page. eBay has a long, a simple, you know, sell your item. It's simple, but it's, you know, a lot of work to sell an item. Here they got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 steps, but there's 3 colors, so it feels more like, actually 4 colors, so it feels more like there's maybe 4 steps. And it's really a pretty good compromise for a single page. Having to scroll through this doesn't feel overwhelming, even though it's still a number of steps. And we've cut it up, made it visual, and those sort of things. So it's a nice approach to that. Testing, though, does reveal a lot. Like with our Netflix recommendation layer that comes up, we have this anti-pattern I call Stalker that, you know, as you'd scroll, it would kind of follow you around. And then what we did was we redesigned this so that it was wider, box shots were bigger, and just, you know, a few fewer choices. And the take rate went up by 21%, which is pretty amazing. The next one is offer an invitation. And this is getting back to the whole discoverability problem we talked about. You know, you can do several things to make people want to interact and go to the next step. This is an example from Yahoo login. They used to have a dog ear invitation where it's kind of dog eared. It says protect my account, and the idea is to get your attention to click on that, to add a custom image so you know that you're not being phished. And we use something called, it's basically you've returned a movie and we want you to rate it. And when you do, we'll show you 2 movies you love. These are blank slots that we fill in for you, so it's inviting you to fill those in by rating. And then there's a blank slate invitation from 37 Signals. You know, you've got a new page. What do you do with it? Okay, this is my own page. Use these links to fill in your page. Need inspiration or a tutorial? So they're taking the normally blank space and using it to teach you and invite you to the next levels of interaction and how to do things. Simple things are just do 1, 2, 3 messaging to give an overview of the site, clear call to actions, you know, tour invitations, which sometimes I call tourist interruptus, you know, where you're basically interrupting the flow of the user in their first day one experience to call out through highlighting the various features of the site. And you can make it as simple as just 1, 2, 3 and the big next button and each step through, and there's just 3 things get called out. The spotlighting works well. Sneak peeks, where you let a little bit of the next, you know, box shot kind of show so you know the carousel will roll them in. These are all techniques to bring in invitations. And invitations really are about addressing that discoverability issue. And Facebook, how do you know, that I'm supposed to set a status? Well, it says, what are you doing right now? And when you hover over it, or actually you click in it, you get the bill is, oh, I'm supposed to fill this in, oh, I hit the post button. All those things kind of came up, and it's a step-by-step interaction. This prompt-based invitation is a popular one and does well. This is from Discus, which is a blog commenting system you can add to your blog, and it just shows the concept of having just an edit link. It's just as simple as that. You click the edit, and you can edit the comment. This is the old Yahoo Photos. Excuse me for the blurriness, but the site doesn't exist anymore, so it's an old screenshot. You've got a view from the top. This is in Paris. This is Eiffel Tower. And as I hover, I get a blue highlighting. As I click, I get an edit affordance. You know, I type it, I move out, and the edit affordance goes away and returns back to normal display. It's a very implicit type of discovery. And it's because you have lots of these on the same page, and you don't want to clutter the page visually with a bunch of editing affordances. And then the own hover, like we talked about earlier, is another way to make the discoverability, like in Flickr. Again, you know, there's no easy answer. Using hover to reveal information, using the familiar, like hyperlinks or drop-down arrows, things you're already familiar with, those things really help in inviting the user to the next phase and the next step. This is a fake view of Backpacket. If I was to turn everything on, you see it would be very, very busy, so it's better to do it on hover invitation. and use these invitations to your advantage. Drag and drop, you know, has interesting moments, and I'll kind of move through these because we're just running right at the 11 o'clock time and I want to turn it over to questions. But basically what I'm doing is during the drag and drop, like we talked about earlier with the gobbler, I'm taking care of highlighting and showing the times to interact. And then you can just do things statically, like drag things here to edit them. Again, bridging the old with the new, hyperlinks as actions, and revealing with hovers, and showing drop-down clues, all these things are ways to dynamically invite a user to the next level. So I talked about mousetrap. I won't belabor that point. And this is another example of mousetrap where you just hover and you know, you get this big zoom out of the map and you're trapped in there. The last point I want to go over and then we'll turn over to questions is around transitions. These are animated effects and cinematic transitions. And there's a lot of these listed on the Yahoo Design Patterns site that I put out when I was there. So what you want to do with transitions is really speak to the brain, because what happens is if you make things move, zoom in, fade, color changes, your brain's going to catch it no matter what. There's a good book called Mind Hacks I recommend to you that discusses this phenomenon. And you can end up actually sending the wrong message, like with the Apple widgets. You know, you get done with them. Instead of going away, they kind of fly at you, which is kind of an opposite of what you'd expect when you're putting them away. And here, Flickr Zeitgeist, you know, what happens is I'm looking at my blog, and all of a sudden I saw something happening, and by the time I look back over, the next thing's coming in. So the actual transition, the zooming down, caught my eye more than the fading did, and I end up seeing a different thing than I was looking for. You know, you can do things like causing things to, when you delete them, you can fade them out and close the area, the gap, and do sort of self-healing transition. You can use zoom boxes to zoom out. You can use motion to give you the concept of moving through time, like in Flickr. You can put feedback and leave it up just for short periods of time, spotlight it. So with transitions, you can speed up time. You can by showing some kind of status messaging. You can slow down an interaction by making the thing happen, and kind of slow down the actual transition into animating the motion so it doesn't happen instantly and see what happened. You can show state change, like when you're deleting stuff. You can show relationship between objects, like zooming out. And you can focus the user's attention somewhere, like with the spotlighting technique. These are powerful things that transitions give us. And animated effects. One of the things to keep in mind, though, is that you're tempted to overdo the animations and transitions when you do them because you're focusing on that effect. And generally what should happen is, a good rule of thumb is, whatever the timing you set up that you think is good, probably cut it in half and it'll be right once it's put in context. And also just, you know, continue to think about less is more, you know. The user only has so much attention, and I don't have the animation here because normally this has movies embedded. I had to break these down into keyframes for this presentation, but we went from a real slow drag and drop animation to a very, very fast one, I think the last version of my Yahoo, it just immediately clicks into place, and you don't need all that extra transition to convince somebody that it really moved. And then here's one from Borders and Anti-Pattern. I call it Needless Fanfare. And what happens is when I hover over Goodnight Moon, I get this flying out thing that's the actual details. And then when I move somewhere else, it actually starts zooming back down. So as I move from each one to the other, I get this zoom, 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 zooming in and out effect, which is really very, very disturbing. It's just not needless. It's needless. Just pop the thing up instantly. It's okay. Or you get these crazy carousels on Amazon that as you start clicking through it, it's either going too fast or too slow, and you can never land on the object that you wanted to select. And the very last one is reacting immediately. And this is really about live preview and feedback to the user. WonderBar is a great example. This is, I start typing, I'm getting a form coming in. I type Fly Boston, it fills Boston in the origin. I type into DFW, more the form fills in, the red dotted line, show me what it's trying to fill in now, leaving on American, July 12th, July 16th, all the details fill in. So it's really giving me a lot of good stuff. That's a really powerful technique. Things like live suggest, you type a question in, you get alternate questions that may have already satisfied your what you're looking for, the whole autocomplete thing with mail and kayak, busy indicators showing the actual busyness right there in context, gives a way to react immediately, searching for domain names like in Small Biz where I do a search and I get the right there in place, tells me whether that's been taken or not. DigSpy, where there's a periodic refresh of new content coming in all the time, so I'm seeing the activity of the community. These are all ways that the interface can react immediately. And you have to do this, though, in such a way that it's designed for relevancy. It's you narrow down on what the user's looking for and don't distract them. With Google Suggest by itself on a web page, may not be quite as useful because it's showing me just terms and not showing me results. But however, embedded in the browser, it's really useful, as we see now, because, you know, as you start typing stuff, you know that you're getting to something that is probably the topic you're looking for, or you spelled it correctly, so it becomes useful. Yahoo had this instant search, which I think they still have on their site. You start typing, and it immediately narrows down to a single item, which is way too specific, even though it's bringing you back search results. We had done another experiment with something we rolled over to alltheweb.com, a property that Yahoo owned. It's now no longer, this example is no longer functioning, although it's up on my Flickr site, companion site. And what happens here is I'm typing Ajax. It's showing me all the terms that match, but each one of those terms is really a tab into the search results. So if it's Ajax or Ajax Amsterdam, the soccer football team, you know, I can click on those. And this was very intuitive, but it cost a lot of extra work on the server side. So it would have tripled the number of servers needed, so it was not gone with. And Roost has this refining search concept, as well as Kayak and a number of others. So as I'm doing things in context, I'm seeing the filtering on the right. These are ways that you can get the feedback, boost the confidence, and let the user iterate, you know, through the process. You can make time pass faster. You can make the application feel more responsive. I'll just skip through that part, sorry. Prevent errors on beforehand, like with Google here, I'm typing a password. The password strength, you know, showing up immediately. We saw the domain name example. All these things prevent errors ahead of time. And you can show what clothes are going to look like on a person, you know, and that's with the live preview concept on Land's End. So keeping the feedback focused, you know, avoiding peripheral distractions, focusing right where the user's at, giving them an indication, you know, the dig feedback of being dug. You can go crazy and have tons of these different, you know, indicators, and it's definitely a bad idea. So that's the, in a nutshell, the premise of the book. There's a lot more examples, a lot more detail. Most of all these examples you see in here are in the book, as well as a bunch of others. So you'll be able to look at more leisure if you have a book and look up the examples and see lots of best practices that I've written up about each one of these concepts. I want to say one more thing real quick is that I am actually hiring for my team. I'll take this opportunity to plug shamelessly that I'm looking for a great web UI engineer. So if you're interested in that, you can send me an email at b.scott@yahoo.com, b.scott@yahoo.com. And Catherine, that's it. I'll be take questions or whatever we want to do at this point.
Oh, great, great. So people, let's. I know a lot of questions have been answered as Bill was talking. Bill, I have to say that was absolutely fascinating.
Great.
And a lot of people have been answering questions, but here's one to get you started, and they're starting to come in. Michael just asked, how do you decide between a hover-activated panel versus a click-activated when you're providing greater detail for an image, for example?
That's a really good question. In fact, we've been struggling with this right now. Yesterday we went through a long qualitative session. I don't have the results back, but I'll tell you what we were working on. We're trying to figure out, in the Netflix site, we have the Add the DVD Queue button. And we also have the ability to add something to your device, like you can play, you know, movies on Roku or on TiVo or whatever else. And you can also play it instantly. So you've got three main buttons, and you know, how do you handle that? So you know, we looked at things like, and also we want to figure out, do you want to take somebody to another page to see the details, or keep having the lightweight detail overlay that pops up? And so we were struggling with this whole thing of hover and click. And the thing with hover is, you don't really know the intent of the user. You can only kind of guess at it. That's why you delay by a quarter or a half a second when you hover over something before you try to activate. And so when you're in the hover phase, whatever you bring up has to be very quick. It can be delayed, again, by a short amount of time to make sure you have the intent of the user. But whatever you bring up can't be too intrusive. So if what you need to bring up is pretty intrusive or is not a side ancillary action, then you want to go with a click for heavier things or for something that's more directly intentional to do. On our site, if you click the box shot, you go to a separate page. That's the movie display page. It gives a ton of details about the movie, et cetera. If you just hover, you get the lightweight pop-up that gives you the back-of-the-box kind of information. So that's one of the breaking points between the two is you don't know the intent. And hover is lightweight. You generally never want to do an action on a hover. I mean by an action something that's going to change the system, like add something or do whatever, because, again, you don't know the intent of the user.
Good. Good answer. Here's another one. It's on accessibility. And Giovanni is asking, which is better for a web app? And he says, in parentheses, say collaborative text editing, to have a separate accessible interface or trying to make all Ajax on the site interactions accessible. Does that make sense?
Yes, it does make sense. And what really should be happening is the Ajax frameworks, the Flash frameworks, whatever, should just handle this for you, or at least provide a way to handle this for you. And I'll give you an example from Microsoft land with their .NET Ajax framework. They have something called an update panel. And what you can do is you can specify something as an update panel. And it's, it's basically an area that you're going to be allowing the user to change some values. It could be one of these inline editing examples, as an example. So what happens is, if JavaScript's enabled and those sort of things, the update panel shows up in a very, Web 2.0 kind of manner. But if it's not, it takes you to a second page. You didn't have to implement that. The framework just did that for you. In the same way, you could set this up for accessibility so that you could provide that as an alternate path. A lot of times with accessibility, it's about providing alternates. For example, if you have a control that's a slider, that's not very accessible unless you have an input box with it to put the value in, because input fields are accessible. I'd provide maybe arrow keys and those sort of things that make something more accessible. Having a secondary alternate path like Flickr does is more expensive to develop, so you'll only do that for very specific things. But what you can do is that, for example, on our pages where we show movies, our box shots, if you hover over it, you get the pop-up. Well, the assistive technologies don't currently announce that the content of the bob, right, the pop-up on the hover. But, however, you can click on the box shot and you go to a movie display page with which the assistive technology can rattle off, and give you the view of it, the what's on that page. So that's providing an alternate path. Hopefully as more and more controls get smarter, I know Yahoo's doing this and others, trying to build controls that have accessibility built in a more base level. And also a lot of the assistive technologies layer a lot on top of the operating system to get around a lot of these issues.
Hey, Bill.
Yes.
A lot of this discussion has been going on for a long time, and I guess people want you to weigh in. The question is Flash versus Ajax, your opinion.
Yeah. Oh, they're both excellent. From a programmer developer perspective, let's just compare Flex and Ajax for a minute. Flex is definitely a lot easier to develop, you know, an interface than Ajax directly, even with something like, you know, I'm biased towards jQuery somewhat in the Ajax world. That's what we're using now here at Netflix that I've decided on after I got here, and we've been real happy with it. Because Flex is a single technology, you know, versus with Ajax, you're dealing with HTML, CSS, you know, JavaScript, and various libraries. So it becomes a little more complicated. However, for a site like Netflix, you know, we have a lot of HTML inventory and, you know, a lot of HTML pages, and so it's a whole lot easier to be incremental with Ajax than it is with Flash. Also requires a different skill set. So if I start introducing Flash on the site, you know, it's almost like a virus. It almost wants to take over. So Ajax, you know, HTML-based technologies are really nice because they're quick and easy to pick up, and you can incrementally add behaviors in a simple manner. Also, you have more control over the accessibility to some degree, although Flash is becoming more and more accessible. That's been a kind of a knock in the past, and it's becoming much more accessible. We use Flash in certain places on our non-member side, you know, for kind of making it more appealing to invite users to sign up to the service. We use Flash, you know, for previews and things like that, but we don't use it for any other part of the site. It's really very contextual. A lot of enterprise applications would do well to pick something that's simpler from a technology perspective. If they're going web-based, like a Flex or a Silverlight, you know, those technologies are easier to develop in that way. But if you've got traditional consumer websites, the DHTML Ajax route, Ajax frameworks serve that purpose better. And, you know, all Dojo and jQuery and YUI and Mood Tools, and, you know, I could just keep listing on and on. They're all good frameworks. And Teresa's pointing out that we've got some posts that talk about central controls and those sort of things you might want to check out on designingwebinterfaces.com.
Good. There are a couple questions about mobile devices, and I know that this isn't your main area of expertise, but it's an interesting topic. And for instance, Raul is asking if you can recommend, but I think he just wants you to comment on a new approach to small display interactions, such as smartphone displays.
Along the same lines, we have
someone asking about iPhone and design interaction for that, given that you don't have the pinpoint precision of a mouse. So how is this affecting designers, and what do they have to do?
You basically have the fat finger as the pointer and the gesturing. As somebody pointed out, O'Reilly has a book, Designing Gestural Interfaces, by my friend Dan Saffron. I recommend that as a great overview of all the various techniques. Azar Raskin is someone to follow, him and Scott Robbins on humanized.org. Azar is the son of the late Jeff Raskin, who was the one who came up with the idea of the Macintosh and is one of the greats of the user interface design world. Azar has followed in his footsteps, and he's been doing a lot of prototypes for the new Firefox mobile interfaces, gestural-based, but a lot of things like, I just had a post on designing web interfaces, and it's around that, one of his concepts called, it's an in-page scroll, I think is what I called it, I can't remember the name of it exactly, but it's basically, you have content that's really just kind of off the page, but you can slot it into play. Any of these virtual paging mechanisms, space mechanisms, are great ways to bring in more content to a small area, to make that small area feel a lot larger. So in the section on Stay on the Page of the book, although I do have a couple examples from mobile, I don't dwell on it. We've been, you know, looking at that here. We've got we did some partnership with Microsoft on the Windows Mobile version of Netflix. And we've been looking at those same things. But it's really around that virtual paging. It's around making targets big, you know, the Fitts' Law thing. It's around a lot of times targeting a simpler interface, you know, just a scaled-down interface to take advantage of that kind of big fat finger, small screen, scrolling, panning, virtualizing the smaller interface. Because we're looking at the same thing. You know, two people on my team are working on our 10-foot UI, our TV user interface experience, and we're helping with building out visual concepts like we did with the Roku box. How to actually browse and find movies on TV devices. So it's similar in some sense, although that interface is bigger. You just got left, right, up, and down, with a pointer, so you're pretty coarse actions, and you have to use transitions if you can. The problem is, especially on TV devices, the horsepower is not quite there. You can't do too many animations at this point. It'll eventually get there, and we'll have the full effects available to us.
Okay, good. Yeah, I've heard a lot of people talk. There's a lot of talk going on about that these days. Now, here's a question from Christian. He's just asking about the techniques you've talked about today. And with regard to accessibility, do they work equally well for users of all ages, comfort levels? And how do you make sure of that?
So first I'll point to a great resource, and that's Dr. Alan Brightman. He's a friend of mine over at Yahoo. He leads the Disability Lab. He has some great resources. In fact, what I'll do is I'll post his resources on the designing web interfaces, because there's a lot of technologies available for those that have any kind of disability. And disability is more than just being blind. It can be you're temporarily sick in the hospital, or your child is recuperating from an illness. So it covers such a wide spectrum. There's not one flavor of those that have a need. In fact, a good portion of our users, I think it's 25% or more, have some sort of a disability where they need large text or whatever. So it's just a challenge. And I think the best way that I've found is to personalize it, to actually get to know some people that have needs like that, watch them use your interface. There's nothing that's better than that. And getting their perspective, I have Victor Sarin, who works for Alan Brightman over at Yahoo. I've had him out to give talks here. And, he's watched him play with the interface, use the screen reader on interfaces, the assistive technologies. His wife has low vision, watching her use the magnifying software. It's called out things we're going to fix here. It's not a one-size-fits-all, and you can't address every problem, but you become sensitized to it and see it as a design challenge instead of a compliance issue, then your focus about accessibility really changes, and it becomes a very exciting proposition to make it easier for everybody.
All right, so we're getting a lot of questions about designers versus developers. Early on, someone asked if a designer or developer should take the lead in interface design, and right now, Richard is asking if you would comment on the designer versus developer programmer divide.
It's interesting. In fact, I'm going to shamelessly plug a webcast I'm doing at the end of the month for Rosenfeld Media. There is a cost to that, but it's a new talk that I've never done before. I'm really excited about the material, and it talks about the whole intersection of user interface designers and user interface engineers, because I've run both kinds of teams. I've worked in design organizations, I've built design teams, and I've built UI engineering teams. So I have a lot of experience with the two flavors, myself bouncing back and forth between them. And there's every flavor known to man. There are designers that code, there are designers that don't code, there are coders that can design. I've got one of my best developers on my team. I actually went to Stanford for design, but he's an incredible coder, but his design skills really play well in rapid prototyping, just immeasurably, because he gets all those little subtle interactions, and there's a lot less communication that has to happen between design and engineering, if you can collapse that space. So there's not one size fits all in that arena. And what I'm going to talk about in that talk, that'll be on February the 26th, and I've got it on my post on the blog, but it's bringing design to life, and that's about what do UI engineers, front engineers, web developers wish that every designer knew to make the whole thing much more seamless between the two groups? Because you have to have a common vocabulary, you have to have a great working relationship, mutual respect, both need to understand how each other work so that you can cut out a bunch of the noise and the needless rework that happens. When you get those two working together, like I've seen it happen here a number of occasions, I mean, we fleshed out 100 to 150 different variations of the button flyouts and interactive bobs and those sort of things within 4 days. You know, because the person on it, you know, had some design flair, but also the design team's very sharp, and we were just able to communicate very rapidly and try lots of stuff. And we went into qualitative through our user testing. We had 7 good things we were testing that we felt good about that would give us the widest view of, you know, what we needed to solve. That wouldn't have happened unless we had a great rapport between those teams.
Okay. Do you have time for one more question?
Sure.
Okay. Here, let's see. Sharif is asking for your thoughts on when UI transitions need to be slowed down rather than being very, very responsive for a better user experience. And I think you spoke on that.
Yeah. Well, it's an interesting one. I think what you should do is try to do it without any transitions or animated effects first. Make sure that everything in the interface is making it obvious what's happening. Then you'll be able to turn the contrast knob up and add, you know, various, you know, techniques of animations or transitions or fades or whatever else as needed. Because, you know, again, you know, as little that you can put in the interface and make it expressive is best. You know, I tend to go more for minimalistic because you're always going to need more attention bandwidth. You're always going to need something's going to get added to the interface, and if you've already used up with, you know, too many colors and too many visual styles and too many things zipping and zanging and all that, then you don't have any room for, you know, future expansion. So start with the most minimalistic approach and turn it up. And if you, you know, what you want to do is basically something, you know, has some, look, for example, on the Apple configurator site, you're doing buying a Mac. They spotlight the changes off to the left. It highlights for just a moment and fades down. It gets your attention. That's a great place for it. You know, when you're drag and dropping modules, you can probably get away without doing any transitional effect because people get it. If things moved around, you don't need it. You know, but if you do put one in there and make it like, you know, 100 milliseconds, really, 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 really fast. That's just some general ideas on that.
That's great. You must be exhausted after doing all this talking. So
okay. I've actually done up to 4 and 5 hour talks, so you know Teresa knows that I don't lack for words.
Okay, that's pretty impressive. But I think we're running out of time, and yep. I see that people are starting to drop off, and I just want to say thank you for an incredible
thank
job.
Thank everybody who came, who listened. I really appreciate it.
And once again, you are posting these slides on your Designing Web Interfaces site, is that true?
I will. I'm also posting on my personal looksgoodworkswell.com, and Teresa will probably have it posted on her.
Okay.
Also, yeah.
Okay, great. And we have recorded this, and I'll send an email out to everyone once the recording is. We have to convert it and post it. And once that's available, I'll send everyone an email. And I would like to thank Teresa for jumping in and answering questions.
Thanks,
that was
Lisa.
Extremely helpful. And Marcy, also for your help. Thank you, Marcy. And thank you, Bill, especially. And
thank you. I'm glad we put this on.
One last thing for people. If you want to keep the chat transcript, the easiest way to do that is just to click in that window. And, no, the recording won't include the chat. So you want to click in that window, select all, and copy, and then post it into a text file or something. So you have a copy of that. If you don't get the chance to do that, you can email me at webcast@O'Reilly.com, and I will send it. Yes, the recording will have Bill's Q&A. So I'm about to end the window, and in the meeting, if you want to grab the chat and save it now, go ahead. And thanks again for joining us, everyone.
Thank you.